call me on my cell phone. Late night when you need my love. Call me on my cell phone.
Phones, Babylon's can't crack the code. Used to sip out styrofoam, but figured I should stick to drope.
Fly me to the moon, let me play among the stars, and let me see what spring is like on
Earth.
I'm like, hey, what's up, hello? Since you're pretty, pretty, soon as you came in the door, I just
went
shuffles in. There's an old man.
I used to pray for times like this, to rhyme like this, so I had to grind like that, to shine like this. In a matter of time I spent on some locked up in the back of the paddy wagon, cuffs locked on wrist.
Next thing I know, you were in my t-shirt, right there, your hair messed up like a Guns N' Roses video. Your shoulder, pull the sheets right off the corner of the mattress that you stole from your roommate back in Boulder. We ain't ever getting older.
You just watched Linguini's opening, and now here's my segment on Super Bowl 51.
Every year, the Super Bowl is held on the first Sunday of February. This year, the Super Bowl was played on February 5th, and it was like no other. Super Bowl 51 was played between the Atlanta Falcons and the New England Patriots.
The Atlanta Falcons won the coin toss and deferred the ball, making it New England's ball to start the game, but they weren't very effective going 3-and-out. The Falcons' first possession started off great with a 37-yard run by Devontae Freeman, but after that run, they only earned 5 more yards, and then they lost yards from a sack by Trey Flowers, making them punt the ball back to the Patriots. The score remained 0-0 throughout the first quarter, with each team punting back and forth. To start the second quarter, the Patriots had the ball, and on 1st and 10, their running back, Blunt, fumbled the ball, and Atlanta recovered the ball and drove down the field for the game's first touchdown. The Patriots getting the ball back, they managed to get to Atlanta's 23-yard line only for Tom Brady to throw a pick six, making the score 21-0. The Patriots got the ball back and was able to put points on the board, but only a field goal, making the halftime score 21-3, and by the half, people already had their own opinions of how the game would end.
I thought the Falcons were going to win just because of their lead and the way they were playing.
I thought that the Patriots would win the Super Bowl, only because of their prolonged history of championship wins and their current quarterback situation, and their team is very solid.
I thought the Falcons because they were winning, blowing them out by the half.
To keep fans entertained at the half, Lady Gaga was the sole performer this year. Lady Gaga started her performance by singing God Bless America while on the roof, and proceeded to jump off the roof and end her performance with Bad Romance. Lady Gaga left fans with mixed emotions about her performance.
I mean, she was okay, but I don't know. I don't think that type of music necessarily goes with football.
I did, just because it was different from previous years. She didn't try and make it like political or make a statement. It was just her.
I didn't like it very much, but that's just my opinion.
Atlanta got the ball to start the second half and drove 85 yards downfield to score a touchdown. With the Patriots getting the ball back, they finally scored the first touchdown of the game, but failed to convert on the extra point. After this drive, the Patriots kept scoring and kept stopping the Falcons. The Patriots ended up tying the game with a score 28-28, sending the Super Bowl into its first ever overtime. For the overtime coin toss, the Patriots won and selected to receive the ball. The first drive of overtime, Tom Brady led his team 75 yards downfield and scored the game-winning touchdown.
I was surprised because I didn't think the Falcons were going to blow that big of a lead, and I mean, I was upset because I wanted them to win over the Patriots.
I went to bed when they were starting their comeback because I didn't want to have to see the end with Tom Brady carrying the trophy. So I put myself out of my misery and went to bed early.
No, I knew they were going to win. I knew when they were down, 20-something points, they would still come back because they're the Patriots.
This marks the first time ever in a playoff game or a Super Bowl game where a team overcame a 25-point deficit and won. To make this comeback possible, Tom Brady picked up his game and set a record of 466 passing yards in a game. This Super Bowl win gave Tom Brady the most Super Bowl wins by a starting quarterback with having 5 wins, leaving fans to question if Tom Brady really is the greatest of all time.
I would say no. He's intelligent and can make smart plays, but obviously, like, his skill set is a little bit below other quarterbacks in the league.
Yes, because he's broken records that no other quarterback has broken.
He probably is. You know, I hate to admit it, he probably is. I mean, if you look at his stats and what he's done, but you look at somebody like Terry Bradshaw, who has pretty much almost the same amount of Super Bowls. He's got one less Super Bowl, and they don't think of him as being all that great. So I think it's a combination of him and Belichick that has gotten him to where he is.
All in all, the Atlanta Falcons started off the game great, but it didn't end that way. Tom Brady led his team to a comeback of 25 points in the first ever overtime in a Super Bowl, and no one can forget Lady Gaga's amazing halftime performance.
I'm Carly Dunbar reporting for Month of Rewind, Season 21.
You just watched Carly's segment on Super Bowl 51. Now here's my segment on President's Weekend.
President's Day is an American holiday celebrated on the third Monday in February. Originally in 1885, in recognition of President George Washington, it is still officially called Washington's Birthday by the federal government. It has kept the name since its establishment as a legal holiday in 1879, and no Congress has ever moved to rename it President's Day. Even though it is the only federal holiday in February, many people don't really know why it is a federal holiday.
The presidents? Probably like George Washington, Abraham Lincoln, I know they share their birthday that weekend. Some of the greatest presidents, so it's an honor to them.
The great legacies of all the presidents we had and what they've done for us.
We're just celebrating past presidents and what they've done in their terms to help this country grow, I guess.
Nationwide, schools have off either the Friday or the Monday of President's Day. But is it really necessary?
Yes, because we got to celebrate and remember those who have done such great for our country.
No, because to be a president, you need to be in school. Like, you need to have, like, straight attendance. So we shouldn't be off school. Obviously, if the next future president is going to have to be in school. Like, he's probably in school right now. So if we're off on President's Day, then he's not going to be in school. You have to have perfect attendance. So, no, we shouldn't have off.
Yes, it's Reagan Bush, 84, easily.
President's Day shouldn't just be another holiday that no one really cares about. It should bring out some sort of feeling inside. But what feelings exactly?
Grateful for the presidents that have raised patriotism that is brought to this country every day.
Patriotic things, I guess, you know, America, whatever, you know.
Patriotism? Red, white, and blue.
President's Day overall is an overlooked holiday. Some appreciate it for what it is, but not many. Hopefully in the future, this becomes a more celebrated holiday. I'm Chris Burke, reporting for Monthly Rewind, Season 21.
You just watched Chris's segment on President's Weekend. Now here's my segment on awards season.
For stars all over Hollywood, the new year marks awards season. Awards season is when celebrities all over Hollywood come together to receive awards for the movies, TV shows, and music that have been made during that previous year. Some of the biggest award shows include the Golden Globes, the People's Choice Awards, the SAG Awards, the Grammys, the Oscars, the iHeartRadio Music Awards, and the kids' favorite, the Kids' Choice Awards. Awards season usually runs between the months of January through March. All these shows are viewed by millions of people, but everyone has their own preference of which is their favorite.
Favorite award show is Kids' Choice Awards.
My favorite award show is the Grammys.
The 74th Golden Globe Awards were held on NBC on January 8th and were hosted by late-night talk show host Jimmy Fallon. The Golden Globes honor the best in film and American television of 2016. The movie La La Land set a record for the most awards won by a single film, winning 7 awards: Best Motion Picture, Musical or Comedy, Best Director, Best Actor for Ryan Gosling, Best Actress for Emma Stone, Best Screenplay, Best Original Score, and Best Original Song for City of Stars.
To light up the skies, to open the world and send it real, a voice that says I'll be here and you'll be alright.
The People vs. O.J. Simpson was nominated for 4 awards, winning 2 of those awards, one for Best Miniseries and one for Best Actress in a Miniseries. The new popular family drama series This Is Us was nominated for 3 awards, but sadly did not win any of them. The Cecil B. DeMille Award is awarded to someone for outstanding contributions to the world of entertainment. The award this year was given to actress Meryl Streep. The award was given to her by How to Get Away with Murder actress Viola Davis. Streep took the opportunity during her speech to criticize, without saying any names, then-President-elect Donald Trump.
And all of us in our community to join me in supporting the Committee to Protect Journalists, because we're going to need them going forward, and they'll need us to safeguard the truth.
Some people feel she went overboard with the comments, while others think it was a message that had to be said.
I think Meryl Streep should have taken a different time and a different place instead of using the podium for accepting an award as a political venue. I think no matter what you feel about the incoming president or a political person, you don't use the podium as that time to say how you feel or try and sway people.
She said what had to be said because Donald Trump is stupid and he is a terrible president. So yeah.
The 43rd People's Choice Awards were held on CBS on January 18th and were hosted by actor and comedian Joel McHale. What makes People's Choice different from other award shows is their winners are voted online by the fans compared to other award shows who just have a group of people decide who the winner is. People's Choice honor the best in pop culture for 2016. Fifth Harmony and Blake Shelton performed during the show, and this also marked the first performance for Fifth Harmony without Camila Cabello. The movie Captain America Civil War received the most nominations with 7, but only won 1. Justin Timberlake won for Favorite Male Artist and for Favorite Song for his song Can't Stop the Feeling. Ellen DeGeneres received her 20th People's Choice Award for Favorite Daytime TV Host. Ellen now has the most People's Choice Awards ever.
But that's not what this is amazing. 20 is, I mean, 17, I get it. 18, sure. 19, I can see that. But 20 is outrageous. This is really something that means more to me than...
It's unanimous that Ellen deserves all these awards because her fans say that she's worthy of it because of everything she does to give back to her community.
I think that she's got a great sense of humor. I think she tries really hard on her show to give entertain the people and give people what they want. So if the people voted for her, I guess they all feel that she deserved them.
Yeah, I think Ellen should have gotten those awards because she does a lot and she helps people.
Ellen's movie Finding Dory also received 3 awards that night, including Favorite Movie, Favorite Family Movie, and Favorite Animated Voice for her role as Dory. The 59th Annual Grammy Awards were held on CBS on February 12th and were hosted by actor and talk show host James Corden. Many of the nominees and other singers performed during the show. Beyoncé had the most nominations with 6, winning 2 of those for Best Music Video for her song Formation and Best Urban Contemporary Album for her album Lemonade. Singer Demi Lovato was nominated for her first ever Grammy for Best Pop Vocal Album for her album Confident. She had some tough competition being up against Adele, Justin Bieber, Ariana Grande, and Sia.
That was some tough competition, huh?
Well, yeah. Even I, of course, everyone in the category was amazing, but my mom was like, you know that Adele is gonna win this. I was like, thanks, Mom.
Yeah.
In the end, Adele ended up taking the win, as well as every other award she was nominated for, including Record of the Year, Song of the Year, Best Solo Pop Performance for her song Hello, and also took home the biggest award of the night for Album of the Year for her album 25, beating Beyoncé for the award, but gave a shout out to Beyoncé during her speech. Award season is an exciting time of year for celebrities because it lets them know that they're good at what they do. Even if they don't win, just being nominated tells them that their fans are out there supporting them, watching their movies and TV shows, or listening to their music. It's also an exciting time of year for the fans because it makes them excited to see their favorite celebrity win the award they deserve. It also makes them excited for the upcoming movies, TV shows, and music to come out that next year and get ready for the next award season. For Monthly Rewind Season 21, I'm Alexa Meter.
You just watched Alexa's segment on award season, and now here's my segment on February. The month of February is dedicated to the lovely senior girls here at Washington Township High School. Throughout the month of February, the senior girls participating in February will be keeping it stylish as they dress up nice every day and have a mandatory dress-up day for each Friday of the month. There are also many other rules implied for February. These rules are made up by our own queen, Olivia Smithson.
So the rules actually did not take me as long as I thought they would. Looking at Bailey's sheet last year, it looked like so much, but Bailey and I are really good friends and she actually helped me through it. She really just outlined like the general traditions and stuff that I had to maintain. And then I wanted to add some theme days and make it a little bit different for 2017. So that was actually like a more creative side to it that I liked. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it didn't really take that long. It was just kind of like outlining it and just trying to make it, you know, the same township tradition as it was last year.
Some of the other rules that are to be followed to participate include classy behavior, changing your social media name to include Miss, and collecting money for a deserving charity. Many girls have their own opinions on these rules that are in place.
I like that. I like the changing your name. I think that's a cute idea. And the charity. I like the charity a lot because it's what I do for Soosh.
They're pretty easy to follow. I mean, you just gotta look nice. You get a bum day, which is good. And then the pink on Wednesdays is just like, it's a classic. It's really easy to follow. So, yeah.
I think they're okay. It's just like, it's kind of hard dressing it up like every single day. So, I mean, I know we get like one dress down day, but mostly every day. It's okay, not bad.
Every Friday during lunch periods, ladies will go around to collect money for a charity chosen. This year's charity we are raising money for is the Unforgotten Haven, an organization that offers assistance to the homeless, sick, abused, veterans, animals, and any individual that has fallen on hard times and needs a helping hand. Olivia expresses to why she chose this charity to raise for this year.
Miss Mason actually brought it up to me, and I believe she actually had students who were volunteering there at the time for sociology, and I looked into it. I thought it was a great cause. I'm all about helping any individual who needs help, and I like that it helps animals, homeless people, children, women, everybody who needs help, like different spectrums and stuff. So I thought that was like a great charity to pick for.
As the senior ladies dress up throughout the month, they must also wear pink on Wednesdays. As Regina George would say, on Wednesdays we wear pink, so they must comply. Each girl has their own opinion about wearing pink.
I think it's cute, but some people like don't really agree with it because it's from Mean Girls, so like the whole point is to not be like a mean girl, and like, I don't know, some people don't get it, but I think it's cute.
Honestly, I like it because it just like already sets the day ahead of what I'm gonna wear and I don't have to really think about it, so. But I am limited to pink shirts. I own like 3 pink shirts, so I don't know what I'm doing after this.
It's my favorite. I like it because I love Mean Girls.
Along with wearing pink, Olivia came up with the idea of having theme days. This is something completely new that Olivia brought to the table this year.
I don't know, I've always just been like a kind of creative, I guess. And I thought it'd be really fun since not many people have outfits planned out for every day, me being one of them, like I want to wear sweatpants every day. I thought the theme days would maybe get people motivated to dress up, and then that would also kind of help the girls become more unified when they dress up. So don't know, thought it would be cute.
With many senior girls participating in February, dressing up every day can take a toll on some. It's not as easy as it looks, boys.
I think it's hard to dress up every day because I feel like boys don't know because they just dress down every day, but in my opinion, like, it's a lot harder than you think. Like, wearing jeans every day is different than wearing leggings every day.
Every day, it's not that hard to dress up. Like, wearing jeans and, like, a nice shirt is fancy enough. But, like, on Fridays where you're supposed to look, like, extra dressy, I'm, like, limited on dresses. So that's pretty hard. But otherwise, like, looking nice in general isn't that hard.
Yeah, I think it's hard to dress up every day just because sometimes, like, I don't have the motivation. Like, if I go to bed late, say if I go to bed at like 1 in the morning, I just don't feel like putting a dress on, like doing my makeup and stuff the next morning.
Despite it being difficult for some to dress up every day, there's a reason behind it all, that being raising money for the Unforgotten Haven. Our Queen Olivia Smithson put together a list of rules that all participating senior girls abide to, and with the addition of theme days, it all came together perfectly. February will always be dedicated to our lovely senior class girls and the charity they decide to fundraise for. And remember, on Wednesdays, we wear pink. I'm Grace Bradley reporting for Monthly Rewind, Season 21.
You just watched Grace's segment on February, and now here's my mail time.
Oh, I didn't see you there. I guess it's time for the February mail time. Let's take a look. Dear Carly, senior trip is coming up pretty fast, about 5 weeks to be exact, but I don't even know what to pack or how to prepare. Got any ideas? From literally every township senior. Well, literally every township senior, luckily I prepared some tips and advice for packing for senior trip. Let's go. As everyone knows, the trip starts with a plane ride to Orlando, Florida. However, there's strict guidelines as to how much you can bring. See, this is way too much. Your suitcase has to be a length, width, and height of 62 inches and has to weigh less than 50 pounds. Not to mention, all travel size containers need to be less than 3.4 ounces. Something like this is more appropriate. So Carly, it looks like you're going to have to take some things out.
Grace, can't calm.
And now you need to know what to put in your suitcase. So here are some examples of the necessities. Toiletries, money, clothing, bathing suit, plenty of sunscreen, photo ID, nice clothes for the dance, and your camera. Along with packing, you need to think of what kind of clothing you're bringing. Now, most people use this as a chance to wear Disney-themed clothing. Some of the best stores for themed clothes are Box Lunch, Forever 21, H&M, Etsy, Walmart, and Target. These stores hold lots of shirts, tank tops, hats, shoes, and socks for both guys and girls. It'd also be smart to bring jeans and a sweatshirt in case of bad weather. The average weather in March in Orlando is 65 degrees with a high of 79 and a low of 56. Just to give you an idea of what you might expect on senior trip. Also, your wardrobe might reflect the itinerary. For instance, day one is Animal Kingdom, and day five is Hollywood Studios. With nearly a month left before senior trip, I hoped I helped you begin to prepare for the approaching best week of our lives. These basic tips and guidelines should get you packed and ready for a flight to Florida in the days following. Days leading up to March 28th may be a bit overwhelming and filled with anticipation, but it'll all be worth it in the end. So, class of 2017, I expect to have one of the best senior trips yet. This is Carly Griggs and your mail time reporting from Monthly Rewind, Season 21.
You just watched Carly's segment on mail time, now here's my segment on Nintendo.
Nintendo is a company full of surprises. They first announced the production of mobile games back in early of March 2015, which no one is really expecting from them anytime soon. All of their games that are released so far are Miitomo, Pokemon Go, Super Mario Run, Pokemon Duel, and their most recent release, Fire Emblem Heroes. As the lifespan of mobile games went down since times like the iPhone 4 and iPod Touch era, Nintendo still decided to push hard and join the platform, still managing to get millions of downloads. Miitomo was Nintendo's first mobile game to hit the App Store on March 17th, 2016.
For it being their first mobile game, it was considered decently successful but lost players quickly. The main concept was to answer questions that the game gives you for all your friends to see, which many people enjoyed.
I thought it was pretty cool. Well, when it came out, you could like make your own like me and get with your friends and stuff. I thought it was a pretty solid idea. I think it was a good marketing scheme.
I thought it was pretty cool for like a Nintendo's first app. Like it's a social game. There's not really much gameplay. It's more of just like messing around with your friends and just stuff like that. I enjoyed it while it lasted.
It was a good idea because like you were able to interact with your friends online and stuff like that, but then it just kind of like died down and no one really played it.
The concept of this game really does not relate to their next game, Pokemon Go. This game was a massive success, overshot Nintendo's expectations, and really achieved what they were going for. Nintendo's goal was to create a game to get players outside and interacting with others, also while having fun playing the game. It had over 10 million downloads within the first week of release, and now has a total of a record-breaking 500 million downloads.
Pokemon Go is probably such a massive success because over the years it accumulated such a big fan base, and so many people like Pokemon, and the thought of playing Pokemon like in real life was just a very appealing idea to a lot of people.
I think it was because it let people do two things that were fun, like game and also be outside. So they got to exercise while they were gaming, and it made them get off their couch and do some things with their friends, meet up outside and walk around and take advantage of the good weather and the summertime.
Along with all the fun Pokemon Go brought to the players, it also brought upon real life threats. One of the main strategies predators used to take advantage of the game was placing lore modules at night. Placing these modules allowed you to obtain a lot of in-game items and were available to all players when one player placed one. This resulted in some cases where players were jumped in locations where predators would place modules at night and hide. This worried some players, while it didn't bother others.
It kind of did worry me. These people were getting jumped over, like they'd set up bait. Then they'd go and then they'd get jumped.
It didn't worry me. I never played Pokemon Go, but I've seen my daughter play, my younger daughter. And it didn't worry me so much because she was usually with people when she played. But I think if she had gone out, you know, she's only in eighth grade, but I think if she had gone out late at night, I wouldn't want her playing that.
The next addition in Nintendo's line of mobile games is Super Mario Run. It was a major success in downloads, but did not meet Nintendo's expectations in terms of economy. This was because it was Nintendo's first mobile game that they charged for. The price was $10, and this was the deciding factor determining if players were to stay with the game or not.
I think Nintendo charging for Super Mario Run is kind of a stupid idea just because of how basic of a game it is. Like, it's just a run game, and I don't think that you should have to pay for something so simple.
It was a very good and fun game, but I wouldn't pay $10 for a mobile game.
Moving on to Nintendo's newest addition for mobile gaming, Fire Emblem Heroes has so far been a huge success. The game was released on February 2nd and already earned Nintendo over $3 million from in-app purchases. This was also one of the higher quality mobile games that Nintendo has made. Fans show their thoughts on the improvement of the mobile games.
I think they're improving a lot because there's a lot more to do in Fire Emblem Heroes. It's a lot more fun. They're learning to put more stuff in their games, and I think that's good for growth.
I think Fire Emblem Heroes is actually a lot better of a game. There's more content, it's a better game. I think it's overall a better game. It's probably something I would play for a lot longer than the other two games, which had minimal content and weren't really something that could hook you easily.
All in all, Nintendo made a lot of money with all of their mobile games. Although they did not charge money to play most of these games, they included various in-app purchases where players can use real-life currency for advances in the game. This option was taken advantage of by many players and is Nintendo's biggest source of income from the mobile games.
They need to make money somehow. Like, phones everyone has, so like they'll be able to have a bigger profit margin.
I was never a big fan of like in-app purchases or DLC, because like if you buy a game, you should be actually like be able to buy the whole game in like one price.
I think that's a pretty good strategy because like the mobile market is like really an untapped market for a lot of companies, and it's a lot more people I think in this like day and age use their phones for games and other things, so I think it's a pretty smart move.
In the end of it all, Nintendo's decision to enter the mobile game market was a risk well taken. They made multiple millions of dollars in games such as Pokemon Go, Super Mario Run, and Fire Emblem Heroes. Since these games had so much success, Nintendo is planning on making 2 to 3 mobile games each year in the future. I'm Tom Capsetta from Monthly Rewind Season 21, and this was Nintendo's mobile application campaign.
You just watched Tommy's segment on Nintendo's, and now here's my segment on Valentine's Day.
On February 14th, people around the world celebrate Valentine's Day. Valentine's Day is known as the Holiday of Love. Valentine's Day originated as a Western feast honoring saints named Valentinus. The day first became associated with love within the circle of Geoffrey Chaucer in the 14th century when courtly love flourished. In England during the 18th century, it evolved into a traditional gift-giving to show your loved ones how much you appreciate them and how much they mean to you. While the act of sending cards and chocolates originated in the UK, Valentine's Day still stays connected to the customs of England. As years have progressed, the traditions of the holiday have traveled around the world. Some gifts are commonly associated with the day. People shared their opinions on their favorite gifts for the day.
For Valentine's Day, I just like chocolates.
I like getting flowers. I like giving flowers. Flowers are pretty, and they smell good.
Flowers with like chocolate or the Chick-fil-A basket.
Along with the gifts, there is usually a date involved. Some people prefer to stay at home and watch a movie, while others prefer to get all dressed up and go out. People of Washington Township shared with me their ideal dates.
My ideal day is going out to a nice dinner and then going back after and just hanging out with the person you love.
Going out to eat at my favorite restaurant.
To go to dinner and then maybe see a movie.
Whether you're buying gifts, taking your Valentine on a date, or staying home for the night, no matter how you spend the day, it is going to be special if you spend it with the right person. However, the holiday doesn't have to be spent with a significant other. It can be spent with family or friends. Although the holiday only comes around once a year, the excitement of the holiday continues to live on year after year. This has been Victoria Bowser reporting for Monthly Rewind, Season 21.
You just watched Tori's segment on Valentine's Day, and now here's my segment on the Super Bowl hoagie sale.
Super Bowl Sunday. As the rest of the world is sleeping in, preparing for a day of eating and watching the big game, members of the Washington Township community are up at 5 in the morning getting dressed and heading over to the high school to help the community in one of the most beneficial events our community has, the Super Bowl hoagie sale. For the past 22 years, every Super Bowl Sunday, students, faculty, and members of our community come together and raise money in a unique way by selling hoagies. The volunteers wake up early and must be at the Orchard Valley Middle School by 5 o'clock to start making the hoagies. They must make enough hoagies to cover the orders that have already been placed and so people can walk in the door and purchase hoagies. Getting up this early and spending hours working hard takes a lot of dedication, but each student is eager to participate in this great event.
Me and the wrestling team got up at like 5 in the morning and go over to the Orchard Valley and help make hoagies, and it was a pain. We were all kind of groggy about it after practicing all week, but it was for a good cause, so it was all worth it.
I mean, that's the Sunday before the Super Bowl. You gotta get ready, you know, because you're going out, you have a night of fun and stuff, because it's the big game. So it's a little tough waking up because you're gonna be up all night watching the game, but I mean, once you're up, it's a good time.
It was really hard getting up for the hoagie sale, but it was for a good cause, so I was motivated.
Each year, the proceeds go towards a family in our community that is in need. The goal of this event is to help the families get through the tough times that are going through and give financial relief to families often weighed down by the high cost of medical bills. This year, the proceeds are going to Derek, Taylor, Colette, Michaela, Dave, Tony, Aiden, Milena, Travis, Christopher, Jeffrey, Chris, and Kevin.
I don't really like know anybody of the benefactors from it, but it still felt pretty good to just help out people that were close in the town and, you know, all around.
Yeah, my family is friends with a couple of the people that the proceeds went to, so I felt like a connection, like personal connection made there.
I mean, it's just a great experience because so many people in the township come out just to help people that a lot of us don't even know.
After hours of work, this year's hoagie sale was able to raise over $500,000. With such a great success, students and faculty members are already anticipating an even bigger event next year and eager to spend yet another Super Bowl Sunday making hoagies.
So I'll be at Delaware next year for college, so I won't be that far away. I'm going to try to come home to make sure I can help volunteer.
Yep, that's it.
I'm looking forward to the hoagie sale next year. It's always fun going out with the wrestling team and just working like an assembly line and getting like 700 hoagies done in a day, so.
Pretty excited to do it next year because I know it's for a good cause and everything. And I always did it every year, so it's pretty fun.
This event has become one of the most popular events in our community. With huge crowds of volunteers coming out to make hoagies every year, it is truly incredible to see our community come together as one to help other people in the community in need. This event has seen 22 years of success and has helped so many families in their time of need. And this event will continue to change the lives of not only those who the proceeds go to, but also the volunteers that partake in this wonderful event. This has been Alex Pierce reporting for Monthly Rewind Season 21.
You just watched Alex's segment on the Super Bowl hoagie sale, and now here's my segment on Groundhog's Day.
Every February, there are three major holidays. However, one seems to be overlooked that involves a special groundhog. This is Groundhog's Day.
Groundhog's Day is held on February 2nd every year. Basically, it is the day that groundhog comes out of its hole after a long sleep. If the groundhog stays out of its hole, it is a sign of early spring. If it sees its shadows, it goes back into the hole, a sign of 6 more weeks of winter. Everybody has a preference of whether they want more winter or spring.
I definitely want an earlier spring because I like winter, but I only like when it snows. I kind of really want warm weather at this point.
Winter because I like the cold more and I like playing in the snow.
I'd prefer for early spring because I'm getting sick of the cold and I just want to get it warmer.
The weather can definitely vary in places. However, a lot of people in the area follow Punxsutawney Phil's prediction, this groundhog, not this one. Phil is a groundhog located 5 hours away in Punxsutawney, Pennsylvania. This is where the biggest Groundhog's Day celebration takes place. The weather on the 2nd in Punxsutawney usually determines whether Phil sees a shadow or not, although some people question if the critter predicts the weather right each year.
I don't think Groundhog's Day is accurate, just because not everything's predictable. I don't know. I don't think I believe it at all, though.
I would say the correlation is pretty accurate, but it's not consistent.
Not really that accurate because it's based off of a little rodent in a hole, and sometimes it's not correct.
Regardless, this year, Phil did see his shadow, predicting us to have 6 more weeks of winter. Nearly 80% of the time, Phil sees his shadow predicting winter, so this year is not new to him.
Only time will tell if we have 6 more weeks of winter. Personally, I wouldn't mind because I like winter a little more than spring. But we all have our own opinions. For Monthly Rewind, Season 21, I'm Miguel Morgan.
You just watched Miguel's segment on Groundhog's Day, and now here's my segment on Pop's concert.
Annually, for the last 20 years, the chorus program at Washington Township High School puts together a chorus concert. For the last 5 years, this concert has been called the Pop's concert. It is called the Pop's concert simply because the show incorporates popular music that the students sing. This year, the show was hosted on February 16th in the Investors Bank Arts Center at WTHS. With a chorus concert each year, there's also a theme that goes along with each show. This year, the theme being We Are One. This theme was chosen to express what's going on in the world today, the community, and symbolizing unity in the chorus program.
I did like the theme. I liked the theme because it kind of relates to like the things that's been happening lately, and I thought that like we all work as a unit, so like I thought it like went really well.
I actually loved our theme this year. I'm a big proponent of the idea that nobody should ever feel like they're alone, and that like everybody always has a place, especially like in chorus class of all places. Everybody can relate to music in some way, so relating to each other through music, to me, was a huge part of our theme, so I really thought that was a cool theme this year.
I think it's really cute how, like, everybody is, it means, like, everybody is the same, and everybody's the same person.
The Pops concert is organized by Mr. Zukowski, the chorus teacher at WTHS. He combines soloists and groups from the three chorus programs, chorale, women's chorus, and mixed chorus, to perform popular songs, old and new, that are well known in today's society and based on the theme of the concert. Members of the chorus program had their own favorite songs that they love to practice and perform.
Probably the senior song, Seasons of Love. Because it was like one last song with all my senior friends.
I would have to say Light in the Hallway because of the meaning behind it and the significance. Even though it might have been our more boring song, I still really liked it a lot.
My favorite song that I sang was That's What Friends Are For.
The show wouldn't be complete without countless hours of hard work and practice. Many members of the chorus program, including Mr. Zukowski, had their own opinions on what the week leading up to the show was like.
Crazy. Show week is a very, very crazy time, but it's all good crazy. There's a lot going on. We're putting the final touches on things we can't do in class. You know, things like spacing on the risers, transitions between songs, who gets what microphone and where do they go, exactly the design of the lights and what goes up on the screens. Like all those details that you see the night of, those aren't really things we can do until show week. And so we're cramming a lot of stuff into those 4 days, and it seems crazy, but it's a good crazy.
The rehearsals were very, rehearsals are a place where you kind of have to try to find a balance. So a lot of it was, okay, let's go to the next song. Like just getting things done was the how we were at the beginning, trying to get everything learned, trying to get everything down. But then once you have that down, then making rehearsal into a fun thing where you get to dance around to the music and you're adding choreography and you're adding your emotions and you're doing things with all the stuff that you just learned. So that was what rehearsals were to me, where that was that combination of work and fun.
Rehearsals were stressful. Like sometimes we forget the words, forget the notes. It was really stressful, but I think we pulled it off the time the concert came.
A productive and crazy week is sure to bring a great show. Members of the chorus program had their own highlights of the show.
If there was one specific moment, it would have to be in the second song of Mixed Choruses, part of the program. They did a song called Black or White. It's a Michael Jackson song. And there's a rap in the middle, and the student that did the rap, his name is Elijah, and we did a cool choreography thing. There was a nice moment, you know, during at the end of his rap that got like a big round of applause. I think with the message of the concert and everything that we were trying to do performance-wise, that to me was a really great moment that night specifically.
Highlight of the show for me was probably Man in the Mirror. That's why I want you to know, I'm starting with the man in the mirror. I'm that skinny to
change his ways. Because it was all over, and it was like, we did this, and like, it was just like a good moment.
Highlight of the night for me was singing with my friend Kyle and then singing the senior song with everybody there, because it was just really sweet and it was our last time singing together.
Tickets for the show were sold at the box office for $5 in advance and $10 at the door. Each year, the money that goes towards the tickets go towards a charity. The charity chosen this year went to Alex's Lemonade Stand. They raised money for the charity through ticket sales, donations, and even sold lemonade during intermission at the show. They ended up raising over $3,000 for Alex's Lemonade Stand. Audience members and family members attending the show had their own opinion on how the show went.
I think the highlight of the show for me so far was just looking. So I was playing in the band down below, and just looking to my left and seeing the size of the performers up there. They were stretched from all the way from the left side of the risers all the way across the stage to the right, and probably five or six layers back. And to see that and hear the power of their voices was phenomenal.
Enjoyed the show tonight immensely. Mr. Z's fantastic in putting his acts together. The kids are talented. And as far as his Alex's Lemonade, big supporter in the city. And I think that the school does a fantastic job of putting the shows together.
Well, my favorite part, actually there was a lot of parts I liked, but I did like the end, not because it was over, but because of the song. I think it really spoke to what's happening in the world today, and a lot of young people understand, you know, the contemporary music and everything. But the whole show was awesome, I have to say. I think the whole show was great. I'm really a big fan.
This year's Pops concert was better than ever, with memories that will last a lifetime. Everyone who was a part of the show put in a lot of effort behind the scenes and on the stage. The performances were well worth the watch, and the long practices were worth it in the end. At the end of the show, no audience member was disappointed, and Mr. Zukowski was pleased. Congrats to everyone a part of the show. I'm Samantha Honda, reporting for Month 31, Season 21.
You just watched Sam's segment on the Pops concert, and now to my segment on Girl Scout cookies.
Every year, the Girl Scouts of America sell Girl Scout cookies. Between the history of the cookies and how the money is earned, and the different variety of flavors, the cookies are one popular fundraiser that occurs each year. In 1917, in Oklahoma, the Girl Scouts of the Mistletoe Troop came up with an idea to fund a project by selling the cookies they made in their own kitchens. The sales for the Girl Scout cookies took a launch in 1922 with the special sugar cookie recipe that was published in the American Girl magazine. They held their first sale in Philadelphia in 1933. By the late 1930s, the Girl Scout sales gained a lot of popularity and could no longer bake enough cookies for everyone in their own kitchens and had to call bakers to help out. People may wonder where all the money goes when they sell their cookies.
So my favorite Girl Scout cookies are the Samoas or the Caramel Delights, whatever you want to call it. And then I also like Thin Mints, but only if they've been frozen.
Thin Mints? Because they're awesome.
My favorite Girl Scout cookie is Thin Mints, I guess.
100% of the money stays local and goes to your community. Each year, this sale grows wider and wider with a different range of cookies and promotion. Running from January through March, many Girl Scouts sell cookies to friends, family, workers, or even to public places such as outside grocery stores. Luckily, the prices of all cookies are the same, coming in at $4 a box. Some people have different opinions as to the pricing of the cookies.
I think it's good if you buy like one box, but if you buy like 15, like I do, then they get kind of pricey.
It has been the same price for a while. I think that per cookie, it's a little pricey, but I believe that it helps fundraise, which is why it is the way it is.
Yeah, you only get them once a year, so.
In 2015, the debut of the digital cookie expanded. Since there are so many different types to choose from, people have their favorite type of cookie. The flavors they have are Thin Mints, Thanks-a-Lots, Lemonades, Gluten-Free, Caramel Delights, Shortbread, Cranberry, Peanut Butter Sandwich, and Peanut Butter Patties, and S'mores. For the past few years, they have been coming up with the new cookies to release. In 2015, they came out with a digital cookie using technology to help position the Girl Scouts' futures. In 2016, they let the Girl Scouts meet the female innovators in STEM to see what a future STEM looks like. And this year, to celebrate 100 years of Girl Scout cookies, they created a new flavor called S'mores. For 100 years, everyone seems to enjoy the time of the year to buy cookies. But what is the real reason they buy the cookies? For a good cause, or just because they like the cookies?
I have no idea. Girl Scouts. That's all I know.
I have absolutely no idea.
No idea. Probably to the Girl Scouts.
As you could tell, 100 years later, the Girl Scout cookies grow stronger each year, with the addition of many different flavors, along with the love of the cookies that come around once a year. The Girl Scout cookies continue to grow annually. All in all, the Girl Scout Cookie Project is one of many important fundraisers that many people have participated in. This is Allie Torney reporting for Monthly Rewind, Season 21.
You just watched Allie's segment on Girl Scout cookies, and now here's my segment on Don't Cry Over Spilled Milk Day.
There are many holidays that get upset when no one celebrates them, but they shouldn't cry over spilled milk. Just ask Don't Cry Over Spilled Milk Day. Don't Cry Over Spilled Milk Day is a day that preaches optimism and to not sweat the small stuff. I'm Ryan Peterson, and this is Don't Cry Over Spilled Milk Day. Don't Cry Over Spilled Milk Day occurs on February 11th. To celebrate this holiday, all you have to do is to be optimistic and let bygones be bygones. The history of the proverb, Don't Cry Over Spilled Milk, traces back to the year 1659 in a document written by historian James Howell. It stated that the proverb was most likely brought up in European folklore. According to the old tales, fairies were particularly fond of milk and would drink up any spills left behind. Even though many people do not know of the existence of Don't Cry Over Spilled Milk Day, those who do have their own idea of what this holiday means.
Don't Cry Over Spilled Milk Day celebrates a very good day about warm glasses of milk that have just fallen over.
I think it celebrates that, like, you don't
don't worry about the like the little stuff and like focus on things that actually matter in life so you can like progress through.
I don't know, not crying over milk you spilled on the ground or something.
Don't cry over spilled milk day is a day that preaches positivity and to not overreact to the small things. Even though events can be depressing, this holiday could be a bright spot in the year. The idea of this holiday excites people.
It's a great idea. because like I said, like, you know, sometimes you really gotta let go of the little things and you gotta like live life to the fullest and just don't worry about the little stuff.
I don't really know why you'd like dedicate a whole day to optimism when like you can just be an optimistic person in general. I mean, it'd be like saying like, oh, today's the day I'm gonna like eat, and then like, but you refuse to eat any other day. Like, why would you do that? That's not healthy. It's not good for you.
Don't cry over spilled milk day is not really well known. However, that could gain ground if people wanted it to. So the question has arisen whether or not it should be celebrated in a more widespread fashion.
Yeah, stress is a huge deal in the world and like people can die from it. So it'd be nice that if everybody in the world could just kind of like, you know, be carefree.
The past is the past, but the future remains unwritten. Students who had not known about this holiday until now consider celebrating it in the future.
Like, there's so much going on these days, and as time goes on, more things are going on. People are getting like busier.
I mean, totally. I like, feeling happy is a pretty good thing. Like I said, I can't feel it anymore, but you know what? I'll definitely pretend like I'm happy, wear like one of those masks that show my happy little face.
I would, because I need to kind of learn to kind of let things go. Sometimes I hold a lot of things to in my mind and stuff, and I just need to like just set myself free.
All in all, Don't Cry Over Spilled Milk Day is a holiday that not a lot of people know. Those who do know of it consider it a bright spot in the year. Reporting on a holiday that preaches optimism and positivity, I'm Ryan Peterson, signing off. You just watched my segment on Don't Cry Over Spilled Milk Day, and now here's Ben's teacher feature.
Washington Township High School has a large number of teachers, all of whom cultivate and advance the minds of the students. Some of these teachers, understandably, have a great impact on their pupils. These teachers become more than just educators, but role models and idols to the young learners. When the time comes for one of these teachers to retire, therefore, the school must prepare for a drastic change in atmosphere. Such is the case for Mr. Robert Barnshaw, veteran history teacher who has been teaching here for decades and is the subject of this teacher feature. Over the last 36 years, Mr. Barnshaw has been touching the minds and hearts of his students. His impact stretches far and wide, as even fellow teachers, such as Ms. Mears, were once his students. Having always been a teacher of U.S. history, Mr. Barnshaw has spent the majority of his time teaching sophomores and juniors at various levels of education, though primarily AP. Having been here so long, Mr. Barnshaw is able to reflect upon his experiences and recall those which he considers his favorite.
So it's just been very interesting, and it's been very gratifying, and I'd like to think that some of the things that I've been able to help accomplish have done some good for some folks, and that is enormously gratifying, and I thank God for the opportunity, really the privilege of having been a teacher for all these years to such wonderful kids.
The students who take his class have their own favorite aspects of studying with Mr. Barnshaw.
So him dressing up and like playing all the characters for like the lessons.
I love all his background knowledge. Whenever we're learning something, he always adds his own, like outside of the PowerPoint. His PowerPoints are thorough. And he teaches us everything, answers all our questions, encourages us to ask questions. So it's probably my favorite part, just listening to him talk.
He kept it entertaining. He was happy all the time, even if he probably actually wasn't. He just made it seem like he was, and I don't know, made you feel involved, which is rare for a history teacher. Normally just lecture forever.
After being here for so long, Mr. Barnshaw has become a staple of WTHS. His retirement, therefore, is a drastic change. He has decided to leave later this spring, much to the chagrin of many a student. Mr. Barnshaw considers his time at the school and discusses his decision to retire.
The positives of what I've been doing have far outweighed the negatives. And I'm not leaving because that's changed. But I think the other aspects of my life have, and the way the profession has changed, the way the expectations, I think, of public education have changed, have convinced me that it's time for me. My time has come.
After being at the school for 3.5 decades, Mr. Barnshaw's life is also expected to change. He recalls what about the school he will miss the most.
It comes down to, you get into this profession because you want to teach subject and teach children. And I'm going to miss the kids. I'm going to miss the way that they've helped keep me mentally young. I'm going to miss the enthusiasm that they show. I'm going to miss the perspectives they bring to subjects that come up. And I'm going to miss them as people. And all of that put together, I got into this profession because I couldn't think of a better way to make a contribution to our country and our society, and I look back on it and I still think that's true, and that's what I'm going to miss.
Most importantly, Mr. Barnshaw wonders about the effect his retirement will have on the school which he has for so long called his second home.
I think there will be some individuals who might miss me as a person. That makes me feel good, but I think overall in terms of the program, I don't see any reason why it shouldn't just get stronger. I think the people who are going to be hiring my replacement know exactly what the needs are. I think we have a fine administration. I work for a fine department chair. I don't see any reason why the program itself is going to suffer. In fact, the program will be better. But if there's a few people who think back on A32 and Barnshaw, and you know, they get a little wistful and remember some good times, that's what I'm going to be doing too, and that'll be part of the gratification.
Those students who have learned under Mr. Barnshaw are also now forced to consider how his absence will change the school.
He really deserves the retirement. I'm sad to see him leave the school, but I'm happy for him that he gets to stop working for a while. Or forever, I guess.
It's really sad because he was one of my favorite teachers.
I am happy for him, but I feel bad for future people who aren't going to have a chance to have him because it was best history class I've had.
However, it is not just the students who will miss Mr. Barnshaw. Over his time here, he has developed a number of relationships with his fellow teachers and the school administration. The other staff members reflect upon their peers' decision to retire.
I think Mr. Barnshaw is one of the teachers who is irreplaceable. There aren't many. He's one of the few people that I've never heard anybody say a bad thing about. And when you lose somebody like that, I think it does change the atmosphere.
He's a man that has made a great impact over the years at Washington Township High School. He's a true gentleman, and he's really a role model. A role model not only to the students that he teaches and has come in contact with over the years, but I believe he's a role model for other teachers and somebody that they should look up to, too. So his effect of leaving Washington Township's leaving a true gentleman, a scholar, and a great teacher, and he will be missed.
Mr. Barnshaw has been a key facet to the education of innumerable Washington Township students during his time at the school. He is beloved by his pupils and appreciated by his colleagues. The school looks back on his career in happiness and prepares for his retirement. Though his career teaching at WTHS is coming to an end, Mr. Barnshaw's impact upon his students and his workplace will last indefinitely. Reporting for Monthly Rewind, Season 21, I'm Ben Kerwin.
You just watched Ben's teacher feature, and now here's my segment on Super Bowl commercials. This year, over 114.4 million people have watched the Super Bowl. While majority of the people watch the Super Bowl for the actual game, a good amount will watch for the commercials. To some people, these commercials have left them remembering the commercial and what it had meant.
The commercial that stuck out to me was the Mercedes one, just because I like the cars.
I think the Budweiser commercial like really stood out to me because the guy like traveled from a different country and he came to the United States and he was like really successful. And I like really liked their commercials like from previous years too.
I like the Bud Light commercial with the dog and the ghost of Bud Light's past. I really thought that was some good marketing and that caught my attention.
According to CBS President Leslie Moombs, a 30-second spot during this year's Super Bowl will cost marketers a whopping $5 million. That's up from $4.5 million a year ago, and that's a 66.6% increase from what the price was just 5 years ago. Viewers have different views of thinking the price of the Super Bowl commercial is worth it or not.
Yes, I think it was worth it because the amount of people that watch the Super Bowl, I feel like they will get their money in return for it.
No, I really don't think it's worth it because I feel like during commercials, that's when people like go and grab like a snack or a drink or something like that.
Absolutely worth it because you get your message out to a larger audience.
A survey by marketing analytics agency Adolescent shows that 87% of viewers who watch the Super Bowl ads are doing solely for entertainment or social purposes, and only 6% watch to discover new brands, products, or services. Less than 1% watch to influence any kind of purchasing.
Some viewers have bought products because of these commercials. During the Super Bowl, I saw a commercial for Skittles, and it really made me crave them, so I went out and bought some.
No, I have never bought anything due to a Super Bowl commercial.
I did buy Cheetos because of the Cheetos commercial, so yeah.
This year, a commercial made by Anheuser-Busch was made on the political events that had happened in our nation's capital recently. The commercial was focused on how Bush overcame discrimination and achieved success when he immigrated from Germany to New Orleans in the mid-19th century.
Some people feel as if these commercials were political this year.
I think some of the commercials were political because it's based on what's happening right now.
No, I don't think the commercials this year were too political.
Each year, the companies that produce these commercials try and top the commercial from the year before. Therefore, many people watch the Super Bowl every year. While the commercials serve as an extra source of entertainment, companies are willing to spend millions of dollars to keep viewers' attention. Politics are also a driving source of many companies' commercial concepts. I'm Natalie Rosavuto, and I'm reporting for Monthly Rewind, Season 21.
Thanks for watching our February show. Hope you tune in next month for March.